guys, welcome back. This is your boy again, Adam Slink. How you guys doing? Welcome to another video. I know you guys are quite surprised because this is not the usual video that I usually make. Well, I'm here with my friend who just came back. Welcome back home.
Thank you.
And he's based in USA, typically a USA citizen, right?
Yes,
now.
I am.
So, what actually attracted me to him doing this stuff is because, you know, we have had a lot of issues concerning some particular group. You know, the first time we met, I said LGBT people.
Yes.
And you said, no, I shouldn't use that word people.
Yeah.
I have to use it as group. Mm-hmm. Firstly, can you just kindly introduce yourself? Any introduction you are comfortable giving out, so just introduce yourself.
Hi, everybody. I'm Bucci Miles. From the United States, like you said, born Nigerian, naturalized American, and British by residency. I'm part of the LGBT community, and it's one of the reasons I left Nigeria, and it's amazing coming back to Nigeria and seeing how much growth and difference the youth and people have adapted to and still learning about our personal and human rights. So that's what we're here to talk about today.
Exactly, that's what we are here to talk about. And you know, there are still a lot of people in Nigeria who are still very much afraid to come out as a part of LGBT community or supporting LGBT community, because there's this stigma on them. Like, hey, on our own side, we see them like people who are spiritually disturbed. You know, something that we can pray against, something we can do some rehabilitation, and something we can maybe cast and bind the devil out of them. So when you started, you know, I know it was really, really rough for you.
Yes.
Because you guys were the pioneer in Nigeria. I'm sorry, pioneer. Because then it's rougher than what we are seeing now. Now people are a little bit accepting it in Nigeria. Despite you can walk into this hotel and then nobody will look at you, nobody will stare at you. Despite they do stare, but in their heart, but they cannot just openly attack you on or like what it was then.
Yes.
So do you think we are making progress?
Well, I think it's a combination of things. Like you said, during my own time, it was really, really nasty and very bad. And also it's a little bit about being educated about what being LGBT is, and also somebody being open-minded and heart about it. But at the end of the day, you have to understand this is a basic human right. We, the LGBT community has the right to be human, we have the right to be happy, we have the right to love, because love holds no boundaries. And at the end of the day, we have to know that no matter whatever you're doing, you have to be human and be kind, which is what I try to teach everybody. And yes, during my own time, it was really, really rough, because I know growing up in Nigeria, I was tormented, I was discriminated, there were a lot of fingers pointed, you know, a lot of crap going on. But this day and age, I mean, I've spent 3 months in the country, and I was just amazed, really amazed of how the youths gather together, how they organize themselves, you know, how it's out there being LGBT and how they are advocating for themselves and educating people. But like you said, there are still a little niche or group of people that are just very blockheaded, as I would say, and that just have the hate in their hearts that this is not normal, that this is demonic. Of course, Nigeria being Nigeria, everything is attributed to religion and demonic and the devil or whatever. Let's pray out to the devil. No, this is a human thing. I mean, what did you and I discuss about it's being now decriminalized, that it's not a disease or a sickness. This is not a disease or sickness. We're born with a different kind of chromosome that makes us who we are. We're born this way, and we deserve the right to exist. We deserve the right to happiness. We deserve the right to love. Just like every single Nigerian in this country deserves the right to free running water, free electricity or paid electricity. But look at it. Electricity is luxury in this country. So if you're in a country where you're your mental ability is being educated around a certain form or a certain way. That's what you learn and that's what you stick to. This is not a white disease or brought by the Western or a Western lifestyle. No,
yeah, yeah,
we are here, we exist, we're among you, and we live day to day just in fear. Some of us underground and some of us openly, like me. So, you know, we are here.
And let's go back a little bit down history, your history.
Okay.
So when you were growing up in your family, were your brothers and sisters, your mom, your dad, your aunties, uncles? So just tell us generally what you faced.
It was tough, but first of all, I have to say I had a lovely childhood until, of course, everything that Nigeria is made of, you know, there were family issues, my parents got separated, and they finally got divorced. And being the son, the first prominent son of my father, you know, I was a bit on the feminine side at the time. So everything was like, oh, he's the teacher's pet, he's growing up, he'll outgrow it, he's at that age. At the time, I didn't know how hurtful it was for my younger siblings, because when they go to school, you know, they are turned out, the brothers and sisters, to that guy that is very girly, or that guy that acts like a girl, which was very hurtful. And at the time, I wasn't understanding it because I was just being myself, the daredevil I was, and living my life the way I best knew how at the time. And then as I got older, did my secondary school and got into university, when it became much more obvious that I was a target for bullying and, you know, being beaten and stuff like that, that's when I started taking into consideration my younger ones and, you know, map out routes where I go during the day and where I dare not go at night. You know, basically living in fear in your own comfort zone. And that's not, it's just horrible. It's just horrible to live like that and be a prisoner in your own self, in your own mind and your own body.
Yeah.
It's very rough. But then, you know, as the Lord will have it, I got blessed. I left the country. I ended up in California, San Francisco. And, you know, I just got re-educated. I opened myself up to be re-educated, to understand myself, to love myself and stop feeling guilty. There's nothing wrong with me. Actually, I am myself. I love myself. If you have something against me, then you're the one that has the problem, not me. I am definitely comfortable in my own skin. So, yeah.
Okay, when you were growing up, when you noticed that, yeah, you are a little bit different sexually from other people, from other group of people, not everyone. It's a community. So when you notice this, did you hated yourself at first? Did you try to remove yourself from this position? Like, okay, let me try this and go out with a girl, or let me pray over this, or you think you had a lot of something that was pushing you to tell yourself that this cannot be me, I don't think I'm gay, then that you didn't want to really accept it. Did you go through that phase?
Oh yes, everybody goes through that, because remember, we're raised in a culture where, I mean, what, 2-3 years old, you're going to church, you're either involved in Bible study or Sunday school. So there were no role models, there were no prominent gay people to see. You believed what the society taught you, that this is not allowed, and you'd be punishing yourself. Why am I different? Why is God punishing me? Why am I like this? I mean, I got to the point where, if I had the heart, I would have just popped in pills and killed myself or something, because nobody asks to be different. Nobody wants to be different. Like you, if you're from the straight community, you don't want to be the one that is different from everybody else. So yeah, I felt different. I felt bad. I hated myself. I hated my skin. I hated just the way I looked. But at the end of the day, you know, you can't avoid the way you were created. I mean, this might be a poor example, it's just I don't have anything to go by right now, but if you were born with one arm, you just have to adjust in living with one arm and doing everything with one arm. So I was born gay and I adjusted to, you know, knowing that I'm attracted to men and this is what it is, you know? So yeah, there was a deep self-hatred for myself and I grew up with a lot of that guilt, a lot of that religious, you know, damnation, if I should use that word. And, you know, it was just horrible. It was just horrible till I actually found out and knew that the Lord accepts me this way. He is perfect and he made me in his own image because I have actually put that to a test and know that there were situations I found myself in. And, you know, I just prayed and said, Lord, if this is not meant to be, put me in my grave right now and let me get out of this world. But he kept pushing me forward. He kept on showing me that there's more to this life, that he has a purpose for me. And this is where I am now. And I'm glad to be here and be doing this.
Yeah. And I've had, of course, for the past few days when I knew that we're going to have this sit down.
Yes.
I did a little bit of research and I saw a lot of stories out there. People taking their own life because they cannot withstand themselves being gay,
yeah,
being cross-dressers, because they love doing it. But they don't, they have not understand that, yeah, it's just within them. That is just who they are. So they tried as much as possible to change that about them, but yet they can't change that because that is just how they were created. So now going back to USA, going to USA, do you think going to USA was a way out for you? Like a way how to live your own life freely? Or was there any kind of poverty also attached to it?
Well, I would say definitely the US gave me the freedom to understand my sexuality. That is a given because here in Nigeria, there's nothing. I mean, even if you had access to, you know, materials to read, it was forbidden. So you even had to hide that. But I wouldn't say though, well, you could say I come from a middle class working family and my parents made sure they provided for us what we needed, not what we wanted. So I don't want to use the word perfect poverty to it, but I would say that there was definitely some lack of spark, like a lack of interest. Like I know as a kid, I grew up loving gymnastics, but I didn't have access to any gymnastic classes or, you know, from a middle class family. And I don't think gymnastics was a recognized good sport in Nigeria, apart from football. So yes, there was something lacking in Nigeria for me until I left. And then I found myself re-educating myself and accepting myself for who I am. So yeah, definitely there was something lacking in Nigeria. And now when it comes to wealth, I've met a couple of other LGBT community humans that were growing up from a wealthy silver spoon family. And they had a lot. They had a lot, you know. Whether it was materials to read or whether it was connections, traveling abroad and getting in touch with their side and stuff. But at the end of the day, Nigeria, you know, being the way it is, a lot of parents weren't that accepting. So they still ended up living, which I'm sure you know about the other popular gay as fuck Nigerian in Paris that is now very open and his dad is not happy with him
over
the internet. We're not mentioning names here, but you know who I'm talking about. So yeah, I mean, the country, this is the time to get loud. I think that is it. This is the time to get loud for people to know we're here, we're queer, and we're here to stay, you know.
And is it profitable? Because I've had a lot of people saying that, oh, these people are being sponsored to destroy the world. They have power. So some kind of Illuminati stuff is organizing them to destroy human race. So is it profitable? Is there any kind of organization, anybody at all, that is pumping money into the LGBT community to also know in a way of speaking out? Because nowadays when you see anybody who just accept to be part of LGBT, you decide to see some changes in that person. The poverty, the money, either person is poor, I'm going to go to Bobrisky case, but not now. If that person is poor, you're going to see the person becomes a little bit shiny, you know, the money to eat and money to do other stuff, as long as he hopefully accepts to be part of LGBT. So is it profitable?
First of all, let's just say that Nigerians are very clever people. They are very smart people. And I wished they made an effort to apply their brains, their brilliance to something more positive than negative. They just try to take over and gain profit where there's profit to be made. I mean, let's take, for example, COVID-19 that happened. Palliatives were stolen and people were making profit of it. So today we come out as the normal human beings. We are looking for acceptance and, you know, acceptance and love in the society. There are people going to take advantage of it. Comedians dress up now in drag and have their shows. They are making money off it. Nothing goes to the gay community or the LGBT community in towards giving back or even it being educative. So nothing. Yes, some people out there are making profit of it. But for the big umbrella question, if we're a kind of Illuminati group and there's somebody pumping money, that I don't know of. And that I think that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard of. We're just out here asking to be respected, to be loved, and to be seen as equals because we are humans too. There is no agenda. There is no secretness or Illuminati or men in black, whatever you want to call them, behind this. We are just normal people looking for acceptance and love. That's the problem. That's it. But Nigeria being what it is, they have to find a way to take advantage of it and make money off it.
But LGBT group, they have a lot of power.
Well, you can't blame us for being smart. You can't
looking at the world, USA president is even threatened by the LGBT community more than our own community. Understand?
I love
you guys are so it seems like they give you special attention.
Well, first of all, I love the way that you don't live in the US but have definite information that we have more power over our president in the US. All I would say is for people that have been so suppressed, offended, and just discriminated and hidden in the shadows for years, we are speaking up. We need to be heard, and that's why we're very visible now and very active on what we do. That's why we have a lot of activists out there, you know, trying to make sure that our rights are heard, you know, fighting for our own generation to survive. Because we can't be extinct. We are human beings and we need to be loved, we need to care, we need to grow, we need to learn. And you can't fault us for being very creative and intelligent and growing in our own mind and power. I've heard these rumors that, yes, some of us are successful and this, but if we decide to put our minds towards more positive things than negative things and we excel in it, why would you fault us for that? It's not just because of the gay gene. There's a lot we have to offer in the society that needs to be accepted.
And let's talk about forcing.
I'm sorry?
Force. Using force on us.
Using force on us. Wow.
And you check movies nowadays, American movies.
Yeah.
It's rare not to see any gay into, no, adding them gay or LGBT people into it.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Like, when I say it seems like it's some kind of systematic way to enforce it on people. The other day, the U.S. might, a time will come the U.S. won't do businesses with countries that doesn't sign this gay right law.
Because it's a basic human right. Human right.
Don't you
if
think,
you can't give basic human rights, why do we fucking need to do business with you?
Okay. Well, okay. Don't you think that, in schools nowadays, they teach about it in USA.
Yeah.
In schools, from primary, I don't know how their system are over there.
Okay.
Let me see. For example, from primary, they teach about it, but why does it have to be so?
Because we pride ourselves in inclusivity. We want everybody to be included. We want everybody to be heard. We want everybody to be seen. Let's take, for example, all the movies you watched, I want to take it, I'm not prying, but I want to take it to your 90s or 2000 kid. All the movies you saw back then were all white people.
Yeah.
I mean, even Jesus Christ in the movie you saw was white.
Yeah, yeah.
But now they have movies about Jesus Christ that is black, right?
Yeah.
So we're all trying to be inclusive. Everybody has to be represented, whether you're white, black, red, brown, gay, straight, bisexual, cross-dresser,
mm-hmm.
lesbian. We don't care. Because at the end of the day, guess what? When we slice you, you bleed like a human.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
breathe the same CO2, oxygen we breathe. So we pride ourselves in inclusivity. That's one beautiful thing about the great United States of America. So everybody has to be included and represented for you to see.
But do you think people are still very much outspoken about it? Because we don't want to mention names. We already had rumors about some politician, no name is being mentioned, some politicians, even in Nigeria, still involved in it. But because they are both Muslims, Christians in it, and they are very well-known politicians, but they are still very much afraid to speak out because of the society, how society will look at them, and because of their political dreams, and that they won't want to come out to speak loud about it, and yet they practice it. So now, what do you have to tell them? Don't you think they should come out? Don't mention any name, we are not mentioning any name.
I can't speak on behalf of everybody that is, like you said, practices it, but I can say from my own little experience here in Nigeria, because of the way the society condemns it, and because of the ignorance that is surrounded, shredded in the umbrella of religion in this country, it's a big taboo. It's really detested upon. But at the end of the day, you cannot deny your DNA or your gene. So if they are practicing it, you know, underground or, you know, in their own spare time.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, we just have to ask ourselves the very simple question. What someone does in the privacy of their bedroom, how does it affect your bank account? How does it affect your feeding? And how does it fucking affect your life? You know, if it's not affecting you, why do you have a problem with it? You know, I mean, I think Nigeria as a whole has so much more bigger problems to worry about, so much more bigger problems to worry about than to worry about what one individual or a group of individuals do to express themselves.
And honestly, if you talk about Nigeria having so much problem, that is why me, myself, I think LGBT community can strive here well. Considering the insecurity and so much other stuff the federal government is looking at. Let's talk, for example, Bobrisky.
Okay.
Okay, firstly, do you guys recognize her? And whenever she gets into any problem, because now she's undergoing some surgical operation. So if Bobrisky gets into trouble now with the federal government, will you guys assist him or her?
That's a very huge question, and you know, number one, let's establish the fact if Bobrisky has transitioned to a woman and wants to be recognized as a woman, we should address her as she, or whatever her preferred pronouns are, she, her, whatever. If she gets into trouble by the federal government, I am not speaking on behalf of the United States of America of any capacity whatsoever. Let me put that disclaimer out there first. If she gets into trouble, I think it depends on the kind of trouble she's in and if she seeks the right assistance from whatever allies she has, she should be fine. But I mean, I'm still marveled and shocked that a country that is so homophobic literally watched on Instagram as she transformed to who she is today.
Of course, Nigeria is so carried away with so many other
and
issues.
And more groups, I don't know her personally, neither do I know her individually, but I am so impressed that she went that far and more hail to your elbow or whatever. But, you know, she has done well for herself, so just let her be. Let her be who she is. If she gets into trouble, I'm sure she will land back on her feet and be good. But all I have to say is, Bob Risky is not one person that speaks out for the community. And I don't think we've attached a face or one person to speak out for the whole community. Like I said, we have a lot of activists here on ground in Nigeria that are speaking and advocating for our rights. I might be one of 10,000 faces you meet or so, but not one person is attached that is designated that is doing the work for us. It's as simple as that.
Well, then you know about this late pastor T.D. Joshua?
I heard vaguely about that.
He died on the 5th of June.
Okay.
Did you know this pastor had a section, a spiritual section? He usually parents bring their children and even individuals willingly come to him to help them to remove the spirit of gay lesbianism from them. And he tried severally, and I think he failed, or should I say he succeeded in some, but he also failed in some. So, like I've said, spiritually, people still see this, the LGBT group as people who are being tormented by the devil. Spiritually, mostly these pastors. So now that you are a Christian, right?
Yes, sir.
You are a Christian. And Pope, for example, has not fully accepted the LGBT community, because the other day he said that a priest, a parish, or I don't know how you guys call it, cannot wed two same sex. So what do you have to say about that?
Well, what I have to say is the Pope has said a lot of things, and it depends on your interpretation of it.
Mm-hmm.
My interpretation of it strictly is he does accept the gay community. He says these people have the right to live their own life and be accepted. Okay, let's get that out of the way. Secondly, yes, he did also say that you cannot marry two same-sex couple in an altar.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that he has condemned us to hell or whatever you call it. But it just means that there is still some final, for the lack of a better word, protocol to be made and things to be put in place for that to happen. Because right now, same-sex marriages are legal in a lot of countries and still very illegal in a lot of countries as well. So I don't think he's discriminated or spoken what's ill of us. That is not true. And to your other question about, you know, T.B. Joshua, like I said, I vaguely heard about it. I had to do some research to know about what kind of demonic whatever he was removing. Because if it's some kind, I'm speaking out of term here, so please forgive me. If it's some kind of conversion therapy, that has already been tried and failed in the U.S. You know, like I said, we are born with a different chromosome that recognizes why we are born this way, and it's not a disease, it's not a defect, we are not handicapped, we are able-bodied people that still live normal lives and grow to normal adulthood. So the whole thing, it's just people being educated and understanding that anybody from the LGBT center, from the LGBT community, could be your brother, could be your sister, could be your dad, could be your mom, it could be the next person you're sitting next to. I mean, one out of every or two out of every 10 men in Nigeria,
because
it's very obvious. And the funny part, I think the funny part for me is when I'm here on holiday, I see it right there in the face, but people don't see it. The Nigerian community of men in Nigeria are very homoerotic without even knowing it. So I don't know why they are fighting something that they are so comfortable with, but still fight
yeah,
it.
Exactly. And the other day we talked about love,
mm-hmm.
and we talked about, you know, you just have to be, if you just have love in your heart, then I look at people and be like, okay, you love a girl, right? As a
yeah.
man, and as a woman, you love a man.
Yeah.
You love your sister, your father, your sister. Then when that person then tells you, okay, he's part of LGBT community, what then removes that love from there? What then removes that love? Because firstly, we go to church, we go to mosque, we preach love. And then you see somebody practicing this and it doesn't really affect you. It doesn't really take anything from you, nothing at all. And they practice it in their own bedroom, good and fine. Then why is it that you just want to hate that person simply because it's part of LGBT or it's not part of, well, it's not doing the right thing according to you? So firstly, I think it's all about loving. If you love that person, good and fine. And just allow the person to live his or her life as long as it's not affecting you, it's not taking anything from you. Because I believe God judge. We do not have the right to judge. Even Jesus Christ said it. No, God judge. As long as the person doesn't kill me, steal from you, just allow that person to live his or her life. So the last one now before we round up this video, what is your general message to all the people out there? I'm talking about the rich people. There are some Nigerians out there who are hiding. They are afraid, seriously afraid. You had your own opportunity to leave this country. It's good for you, good and fine. You are lucky. Let me say you are lucky here. Yeah?
Okay.
So what about all those girls, boys out there who are still very, really afraid to come out?
Well, first of all, let me say thank you very much for speaking about love. I think it's very important people should know and have love in their hearts, because at the end of the day, love wins no matter what, you know.
Yeah.
And this is how God created us, to keep on sharing this love, whether you want to think of it in a very bad way or in a good way. We should still recognize the power of love. And this humble message coming from me is, at the end of the day, we're all humans, and it's not fucking easy. It's not easy in this country, but if you can find that one person, just that one person to confide in and be able to trust in, it makes a whole lot of difference. Because I know myself, when it was so hard for me, there was just one person. One person in my life that stood there like a rock, didn't miss a heartbeat about anything I had to say about what made me me. So my advice is, find out one person, confide in that one person, and keep the struggle going. Sometimes it feels like the rug is pulled from under you and you're just slammed to the bottom and there's no getting up again. Get back on your feet, one day at a time, take it easy. Nigeria needs a lot of work. It does need a lot of work, but the stronger you are, the more you are out there, the stronger we are in being represented. So that's just my humble message. But
okay guys, I think that is all for the day, and thank you guys for joining, and have a wonderful day and stay blessed.
Hi everybody, after my interview with Adams Link Media today, I have dedicated a special Instagram. The name of the Instagram is bnb.40. I am opening up this Instagram for your hate mails, direct emails, and questions if you have anything to ask about the LGBT community, and I'll humbly try to answer in my best possible way. And Adam and I might try doing this again in 3 months' time, so you could hear some of the hate emails and how you guys sound. So please give us a shout out at bnb.40. And we'll see you in 3 months' time.